Don't forget to subscribe and turn the notifications. We upload daily, and check the source of this video to view all the images and videos if there was any. Our riveting series of newly discovered letters by Sylvia Plath, by turns erotic, despairing and raging, laid bare her agony at Ted Hughes' infidelity. While Sylvia Plath looked after their two young children in Devon, her husband Ted Hughes was having a secret affair in London with a stunning Assia Wevill. In July 1962, the poet confessed. Here, in previously unpublished letters to her former psychiatrist in America, Sylvia reveals the agony of their breakup. Previously unpublished letters to Sylvia Plath's former psychiatrist in America reveal the agony of her breakup with husband Ted Hughes. While Sylvia looked after their two young children in Devon, husband Ted Hughes was having a secret affair in London with a stunning Assia Wevill, pictured to Dr. Ruth Buescher Friday, July 20, 1962. First of all, please charge me some money. I feel a fraud and a heel to be cadging time and advice out of you for nothing. My last New Yorker poem, Tulips, earned me $270, so I can afford the luxury of a good psychiatrist, which is you. I wrote to you in the middle of my agony week, when I was half begging you to reassure me that at least my old dream idyll was a right one, even if it worked out wrong. The virginity, as it were, of our marriage ended Friday the 13th. Oh, we are very superstitious in our house, and I went to a friend's with the baby, leaving mother here with two-year-old Frida, and went through the whole bloody thing minute by minute. At first I thought, why did he have to f**k this woman in this nasty way? Then, after I had got over the nausea, got the doctor to knock me out for 8 hours after a week of no eating or sleeping, I thought, thank God. I am free of so much. And this was probably the most economical way to do it, although at the time of my misery I thought it the cruelest. I remember you almost made me hysterical when you asked me, or suggested, that Ted might want to go off on his own. This was heresy to me then, the worst. How could a true love ever want to leave his truly beloved for 1 second? We would experience everything together. I began to worry about the purity and strength of my love when I found myself thinking, why doesn't the bastard leave the house and let me put my hair up and dust and sing? I think obviously both of us must have been pretty weird to live as we have done for so long. I was always having nightmares about Ted dying or being in accidents, and for this reason could hardly bear to let him out of my sight. For fear he would desert me forever, like my father, who died from diabetes when Sylvia was 8, if I didn't watch him closely enough. And he must have had enough desire for womb comfort to stick it out. Well, we are 30. We grow up slowly, but, it appears, with a bang. Anyhow, Ted came back. It occurred to me almost immediately that he felt a lot worse than I did. Not sorry worse. He just wasn't purged, because he hadn't had my particular wild agony. The bloody girl is beautiful, smart, but absolutely uncreative and cold. When I was at my lowest, thinking grimly, what has this weavy asshole, her name is actually Assia Wevill, got that I haven't, I thought, she can't make a baby, can't make a book or a poem, just adds about bad bakery bread, wants to die before she gets old and loses her beauty, and is bored. Bored. With herself and her life. Picture the Sylvia Plath and Ted Hughes in 1956, the year they married. These previously unpublished letters show the heartbreak the poet was feeling during the split. She literally moved into our London flat, after we left. She came down here, to the house in Devon, for a weekend with her husband, and wanted to move into my life. Well, the old girl has done me a big favor. The funny thing is, I don't think she must really enjoy sex, except in her head. I'm damned if I'm going to be a wife mother every minute of the day. And as I am a pretty faithful type, and have no desire left for malice or revenge on Ted, to get back at him, I'd just as soon make love with Ted. But coming from a distance, from a space, a mutual independence. Ironically, this great shock purged me of a lot of old fears. It was very like the old shock treatments I used to fear, so, it broke a tight circuit wide open, a destructive circuit, a deadening circuit, and let in a lot of pain, air and real elation. I feel very elated. The little conventional girl wife wanted Ted to come back and say, my God, how could I hurt you so? It will never happen again. But I knew I really couldn't stand him to say that, and he didn't. He told me the truth about the femme fatale. And I didn't die. I thought my capacity for conventional joy and trust and love was killed, but it wasn't. It is all back. And I don't think I'm a suicidal type anymore, because I was really fascinated to see how, in the midst of genuine agony, it would all turn out and kept going. I really did believe it was the worst thing that could happen, Ted being unfaithful, or next worst to his dying. Now I'm actually grateful it happened, I feel new. I have no desire for other men. Ted is one in a million. Sex is so involved with me in my admiration for male intelligence, power and beauty that he is simply the only man I lust for. I know men feel differently about sex, but I thought they, too, were capable of deep and faithful love. It is not very much consolation to me that Ted really deeply and faithfully loves me, while he follows any woman with bright hair, or an essay on Shakespeare in her pocket, or an ability for flamenco dancing. The thought of Ted making physical love to them, registering them under my name in hotels, letting all the people we know see this, hurts and nauseates me horribly. I feel if he really loved me, he would see how this hurt damages my whole being, makes it barren, and deprives me of joy in love making with him. All the stupid little things I did with love, baking bread, making pies, painting furniture, planting flowers, sewing baby things, seem silly and empty without faith in Ted's love. And the children who so delighted me are like little miasmas, crying for daddy. Monday, July 30th. I have been at an idea, very grim, since my last letter to you. What, above all, does Ted think I am? His mother, a womb. What can I do to stop him seeing me as a puritanical warden? Anyhow, Ted is on the rampage, writing letters and even radio broadcasts about the advantages of destruction, breaking one's life into bits every 10 years, and damn the pieces. His favorite poem of his own is pure ego-fascist, about a hawk, I kill where I please because it is all mine. I hate the idea of living here in the country with the children and having Ted go off and sleep with various women. I realize now he considered I might kill myself over this, as did the wife of someone we knew, and what he did was worth it to him. The real crux to me now is what to do about the other woman business. Am I an idiot to think that there is some purpose in being bodily faithful to the person you love? In riding through infatuations without always indulging yourself, if you know it hurts someone? I mean, my pleasure in lovemaking is spoiled by thinking, is he comparing my hair to this one, my shape to that one, my talents to the other? How can I have any self-respect? I hate the idea of living here in the country with the children and having Ted go off and sleep with various women and come back exhausted and refreshed to write, be fed, etc. It humiliates me. I simply can't laugh and blow smoke rings. He hates me to be tearful, but my God, the prospect of this makes me cry. When I think he wants to follow every infatuation into bed, shall I just let him? This is what freedom, it seems, means to him. He is handsome and fantastically virile and attractive. I am not beautiful. When I am happy, I can glow and burn, but what have I in this to make me happy? I don't want to be sorrowful or bitter, men hate that, but what can I do in face of these prospects? What I see now I could not have stood. What would to me have been the real worst, was for Ted to come and say, I want this girl for my wife and to bear my children. I at one point told him, I am saving you from ever getting mucked up with a wife and children again, you can have tarts and bastards, but if any other woman gets refrigerators and nappies in her eyes, you can say you have a really good old wife at home who is saving you to be free and not get stuck in the wallow of domesticity again. The couple had 2 children, Frieda and Nicholas, before their divorce. Sylvia wrote, I am bloody, raw, nerves hanging out all over the place, because I have had 6 stormy but wonderful years, bringing both of us, from nothing, books, fame, money, lovely babies, wonderful loving, but I see now that the man I loved as father and husband is just dead. And he does genuinely love us. He says, now he dimly thought this would either kill me or make me, and I think it might make me. And him, too. What I also need is wisdom for him. He takes a lot of understanding. He is, I am sure, a genius. A really great writer, a handsome and great man. I have been so hurt this week I feel like upchucking at the thought of his laying about with other women just this minute. But I would like to be able to cope with this again, if it came up. If he needed to test his freedom, to test me. And believe me, women are dying to get their hands on him. And on me, too. I honestly don't ever, by cowardice, boringness, accusation, limitedness, ever want to give Ted the chance to think he should trade us in for a better family model. I have come to this country town because Ted said it was his dream, apples, fishing, peace, clean air, etc., etc. I had wanted to stay in London, because I liked all the social life, movies, art exhibits and rush. Well, now I love it here, and this is the first home I've had, very beautiful. But I am damned if I want to sit here like a cow, milked by babies. I love my children, but want my own life. I want to write books, see people and travel. I want, eventually, to make over our separate cottage and hire a nanny. So I've got to work hard. I refuse the role of passive, suffering wife. I think your advice about not having any more children for years a good one. I think I'd like a couple more someday, but only when I've got a nanny to free me. I get a terrific sensual pleasure in being pregnant and nursing. But I must say, I get a terrific sensual pleasure in being light and slender and f**king as well. Can you think of any other discontents of Ted's I might foresee? I think he will need to prove conclusively and perhaps several times, soon, then maybe less often, that he is free. He says this means travel, not tarts, but I feel naturally now the two go together. What I don't want to be is a unf**ked wife. I get bitter then, and cross. And I feel wasted. And I don't just mean the token American what is it twice a week, front to front, thank you darling, either. It might simplify things if I could desire other men, but I need to admire them, too, and find them attractive, and there are very few of these, and I'm not likely to meet them in cow country. Saturday, September 22nd. Your letter came today, at a most needed moment, and I feel the way I used to after our talks, cleared, altered, renewed. I am really asking your help as a woman, the wisest woman emotionally and intellectually, that I know. You are not my mother, but you have been midwife to my spirit. Plath first met Butcher 10 years earlier, the end for me at least, just blew up this week. I have been very stupid, a bloody fool, but it only comes from my thinking Ted could grow up, and my wanting to give us a new and better and wider start. I was prepared for almost anything, his having the odd affair, traveling, getting drunk, if we could be straight, good friends, share all the intellectual life that has been meat and drink to me. I was ready for this, to settle for something much different and freer than what I had thought marriage was, or what I wanted it to be. Even our professional marriage, the utterly creative and healthy critical exchange of ideas and publication projects and completed work, meant enough to me to try to save it. But Ted made even this impossible, and I am appalled. I am bloody, raw, nerves hanging out all over the place, because I have had six stormy but wonderful years, bringing both of us, from nothing, books, fame, money, lovely babies, wonderful loving, but I see now that the man I loved as father and husband is just dead. The end for me at least, just blew up this week. I have been very stupid, a bloody fool, but it only comes from my thinking Ted could grow up, and my wanting to give us a new and better and wider start. I realize, stunned, that I do not like him. Although he is handsome, I can hardly look at him, I see such ugliness. After the first blow-up, Ted came home and said the affair was kaput. I believe this. He said he would be straight, now that I wouldn't be tearful or try to stop him from anything. He only wanted to go up to London on drinking bouts with a few friends. He went up half the week every week. The minute he came home he would lay into me with fury. I looked tired, tense, cross, couldn't he even have a drink, what sort of a wife had he married, etc. I was dumbfounded, his fury seemed all out of proportion. Then I found out by accident that this little story and that about what he'd been doing weren't true. Mrs. Prouty, American novelist and poet Olive Prouty, treated us to a night and a day at the fanciest hotel in London, and I never had such good loving, felt it was the consecration of our new life. He went to have a bath and I next saw him coming in fully dressed with a funny pleased smile. He had called some friends to have a drink. Fine, said I, I'd love a drink. No, I was to go home on the next train. He didn't come back for a couple of days and even then I thought he was doing what he said. Now, of course, I see this saying the affair was over was just an elaborate hoax. We had an invitation to go to Ireland to a poet's house in the wilds of Connemara. Well, Ted lasted 4 days. He left while I was in bed one morning saying he was going grouse shooting with a friend. I haven't seen him since. He left me with all the baggage to carry back, and I got a telegram when I got home, saying he might be back in a week or two. I am going to London this Tuesday to see a very kind-sounding solicitor in order to get a legal separation. Ted seems to need to come home every week to make my life miserable, kick me about and assure himself that he has a ghastly limiting wife, just like his friends do, three of whom have left their wives this year. He beat me up physically a couple of days before my miscarriage, in February 1961. I thought this an aberration, and felt I had given him some cause. I had torn some of his papers in half, so they could be taped together, not lost. In a fury that he made me a couple of hours late to work at one of the several jobs I've had to eke out our income when things got tight. Money is a great problem. We are doing fine, the house paid up, a car, starting to save a bit. He says all he wants is to live his own life and send us 2/3 of what he earns. I am so bloody sane. I am not disaster proof after my years with you, but I am proof against all those deadly defenses, retreat, freezing, madness, despair, that a fearful soul puts up when refusing to face pain and come through it. I am not mad, just fighting mad. The worst thing is, as you say, psychologically, the fear and danger of being like my mother. Lucky for me, I love my writing, love horse riding, love beekeeping and can expand the area of my real interest so that I think my children will have a whole mother who indeed loves them, with vigor and warmth. I don't want Frida to hate me as I hated my mother, nor Nicholas to live with me or about me as my brother lives about my mother. I remember asking my mother why, if she discovered so early on she did not love my father, that her marriage was agony, she did not leave him. She looked blank, then said half-heartedly that it was the depression and she couldn't have gotten a job. Well, no thanks. It is the uncertainty, the transition, the hard choices that tear at me now. I think when I am free of him, my own sweet life will come back to me, bare and sad in a lot of places, but my own, and sweet enough. Saturday, September 29th, I think I am dying. I am just desperate. Ted has deserted me. I have not seen him for 2 weeks. He is living in London without address. Tonight, utterly mad with this solitude, rain and the wind hammering my 100 windows, I climbed to his study out of sheer homesickness to read his writing, lacking letters, and found them, sheafs of passionate love poems to this one woman to whom he has been growing more and more faithful. Many are fine poems. Absolute impassioned love poems, and I am just dying. I could stand tarts. She is so beautiful, and I feel so haggish and my hair a mess and my nose huge and my brain brainwashed and God knows how I shall keep together. I am just frantic. If I had someone living with me, I would not break down and talk to myself, cry, or just stare for hours. But I have no one, no friends, no relatives. The shock of this has almost killed my heart. I still love Ted, the old Ted, with everything in me and the knowledge that I am ugly and hateful to him now kills me. Once I asked if he wanted a divorce and he said no, just a separation, he might never see me for 50 years but might write once a week. I am drowning, just gasping for air. What kills me is that I would like so much to be friends with him, now I see all else is impossible. I mean my God, my life with him has been a daily creation, new ideas, new thoughts, our mutual stimulation. Now he is active and passionately in love out in the world and I am stuck with 2 infants and I have no one. My God, I can't see to thinking straight. How can I tell the babies their father has left them? How do you put it? Death is so simple. I had my life set as I wished, beautifully and happily domestic, with lots of intellectual stimulus and my part-time writing. I feel Ted hates us. Wants to kill us to be free to spend all his money on her. I feel so trapped. Every view is blocked by a huge vision of their bodies entwined in passion across it, him writing immortal poems to her. And all the people of our circle are with them, for them. How and where, oh God, do I begin? I can't face the notion that he may want me to divorce him to marry her. And how to stop my agony for his loved body and the 1,000 assaults each day of small things, memories from each cup, where we bought it, how he still loved me then, when it was not too late. P.S. Bless you for your advice about a divorce which arrived this morning, just in time as Ted arrives too, for the last time. There is a dignity and rightness to it. The divorce like a clean knife. I am ripe for it now. The Letters of Sylvia Plath, Volume 2, 1953-63, edited by Peter K. Steinberg and Karen V. Kuchel, to be published by Faber at £35 in the UK on September 6th. To buy this book for £28, 20% discount, call 0844 571 0640 or go to Mailshop Books. P&P is free on orders over £15, offer valid until September 5th, 2018.